Good morning. Great to see each of you here today. A beautiful day that the Lord has made. Let us what? Rejoice and be glad in it. And I hope that you have come with a heart of rejoicing, that we're able to come together as the body of Christ. We are, of course, each individuals, but we come together corporately as the body of Christ. And so it's great to see each of you here today. We're going to start off by singing one of the old favorites, "To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done." So would you stand with me and let's sing together this wonderful, wonderful hymn. Standing for a word of prayer. Would you join me, please? Our Heavenly Father, we come before you, and Father, I pray that this song was the cry of our heart. Father, that you receive all the glory, the honor, and the praise, because you and you alone are the only one. And Father, we need to let it be known to the world around us who has yet to hear the good news of your love for them. Father, we thank you that as your children, we could gather here together in your presence. You say, where two or more are gathered in my name, you are there in the midst. And Father, we welcome you. Holy Spirit, we welcome you this morning. And I pray that each of us individually will allow you to work in our hearts and lives. I pray that we would open our hearts to be receptive to that which you want to say to each of us today. I pray, Father, for our continued church family. Be with those who are not here this morning, We pray that your hedge of protection will continue to be with them in all that they do. And I thank you for those who are here this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to come out and to be in your presence. And Father, we just pray that everything said and done would give you praise, honor, and glory. For I pray it in the wonderful, glorious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Want to welcome those of you who are visiting with us today. We're honored that you have come to worship with us. Our goal is to worship God and to hear from God. And I hope, like I said in my prayer, that you have come being receptive to that which God has to say to you individually, not to the person to your right or to your left, but what is it that God wants to say to you today? And then as God speaks to us, we go out and we share it with someone else. I believe God wants us to grow in our relationship with Him, but I believe He wants others to grow by us being involved in their life and sharing our story, sharing how God has grown us, that He can grow them as well. You know, sometimes people get discouraged and they just need somebody to come alongside them and give them a little encouragement. And that goes for Christians as well. You know, some of us can get discouraged. And I've always often said that when we come to church, it's not just for ourselves, but what can we do for somebody else? Or maybe what can we give away to somebody else that would be a word of encouragement and uplift for them? You know, maybe they go through this week and had a difficult week, and maybe we can relate with them and share a story of how God brought us maybe through a similar situation. Whatever it might be, look for those opportunities, because I believe they're all around. Whether it's in the church or outside the church, there are opportunities for us to be a blessing to the body and to those outside the body. Let me share just a few announcements with you. One of the first ones I want to share is the seniors are going to be meeting today this week. And they are actually this coming Tuesday. We are going to White Bank Park. Okay, some of you know where that's at. I do not know where that's at, but I have directions. Okay, and out in our foyer on the little table out here is a little slip with directions. If you don't know how to get there, please take one of these. We're going to have a picnic outdoors. I know they have a picnic tables and stuff, so rain or shine, we're still going to be meeting because we'll be under a shelter outdoors. So invite somebody to come along with you. It is bring your own lunch and bring your own drink. Okay, we're not bringing to provide for everybody, but you bring and we'll enjoy each other's fellowship. Like I said, last month we met out in our church parking lot. We just kind of circled our chairs, our lawn chairs, and it was a little windy and bit cold that day, but I would venture to say all those that came had a great time. It was good to see each other again, and that's the purpose of us getting together, is to have that good fellowship that only believers in Christ can have with one another. And so that is 11:30 this coming Tuesday at White Bank Park. All right. Now there's another announcement outside on that same table or out in the foyer is a jug. Normally during Mother's Day and Father's Day, we give to the Pregnancy Care Center, okay, supporting that ministry. A lot of times we used to give out the baby bottles. Well, COVID has kind of messed things up a little bit, but we have a jug out there if you have loose change you want to put in. I know some of you in the past have written out a check and slipped it in there. However you want to do it, I know it is available for change or however you want to do it, but we, through the years, have been a blessing to this ministry. I know they have appreciated us coming alongside them. And the goal of this ministry is to reach out to young ladies who find themselves in the motherly way. You know, the option that the world wants to give them is just go down and have an abortion. But for those of us who believe that that is not God's intent for that little child, this ministry comes alongside them and encourages them to either have the child, and they would help them with support, or put it up for adoption. Allow some other family to be blessed by this little child. And so we agree with what their ministry is in ministering to families. And so if you want to be a part of that, we would love for you to either give through the jar in your loose change or some other means by cash or check. All right. I believe that's all the announcements I need to share with you this morning. So let's continue our worship by singing, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is Thy Faithfulness. You're willing to stand with me one more time? Let's stand together, please. But I want you guys to drop out, okay? And we're going to let their voices be heard this morning, okay? So, Joyce, when we get to the chorus, you drop out. Carol, when we get to the chorus, you drop out. Okay, you're all right with that? All right. We appreciate our pianist and our organist, don't we? Right. But we're going to try something different. Okay. All right. Take us there.
Pardon for sin and peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000
At this time, Carol is going to bless us with a beautiful song. This is a song that I have sung for many years, and maybe many of you had too, but it reminds us of our mission here on earth. God saved us for that purpose, and that is to go out and tell people about Jesus Christ. The song she's going to play is People Need the Lord. Thank you so much, Carol. We are blessed with a great pianist and a great organist. And I sure do appreciate their wonderful music. Carol's a great singer, too, but she opted today to just play from the heart. And I know Joyce has commented to me before that this is her opportunity, a way of praising the Lord, is by rattling those keys and at the same time lifting, you know, her praise up to the Lord. And I know that probably goes for the both of you, but great job. All right, at this time, our children are going to be allowed to leave and go to children's church. And so our ladies will be going and meet out in the atrium here. If you can meet them out there, they have a wonderful lesson, a great time prepared for you today. And so we're allowing our children to go. All right, for those of you who remained, we're going to continue in our study. We've been talking about questions about the future. People oftentimes wonder, what does the future hold? What can we expect in the future? And I know this is probably the big topic that we are facing today because our world is ever-changing, changing so fast, and we're trying to understand and sort out all the things that are going on in our world. And what I'm going to be sharing with you today, and I ask the question in this form, what is the next event after the rapture of the church? couple weeks ago, we talked about the rapture of the church. That is when Christ is going to return, not physically come to earth, but return in the clouds. We talked about the trumpet will sound, the archangel, the voice of the archangel, and we that are in Christ will leave and go to be with our Lord and Savior in heaven. Okay? I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward to that. And I know many of us pray, Lord, may it happen in our day. Excuse me. Because we know the other way is through death. And the more I've been reading and studying this, death is just, you know, going from here to there. You know, the thing that I guess we may fear about death is it going to bring pain or what am I going to have to go through? But the actual, when we actually die, it is going from earth to heaven in an instant. Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And back about a month ago, I shared with you out of Luke chapter 16 of in paradise that the Old Testament saints went to paradise, but when Christ rose again from the grave, he cleared out paradise, and now everybody goes to heaven to be with the Lord. And the rapture is going to take place. It will take millions of Christians from around the world to be with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, actually, there are going to be two events taking place at the same time after the rapture. One on earth and one in heaven. For the unbelievers and the other one for the believers. After the rapture of the church on earth, the tribulation period will begin. This will also be the time when the Antichrist comes to the forefront. Today we are going to begin our study on answering the question by focusing on the person of the Antichrist. Knowing myself and the material that I have, this will at least be a two-part sermon, maybe even three. But I want to begin this morning and look at the passage out of the New Testament, out of 2 Thessalonians. And later in the message, I will share with you another important passage. But let me share with you out of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, should appear on the screen, verses 3 through 7, which say this. And let me give you a little bit of foreknowledge of what was going on. Paul was writing to the church at Thessalonica. There were those that had already said that Jesus Christ had returned. And some of the Thessalonians were a little upset about that. So Paul addresses it, and he says it in this way. Don't you be fooled by what they say, for the day will not come until there is a great rebellion against God, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the one who brings destruction. He will exalt himself and defy everything that the people call God and every object of worship. And he will even sit in the temple of God, claiming himself to be God. Now, to say the least, the Bible, to many people, and many of us here today, is a complex book. And nowhere is that truer than in the area of prophecy. Just about every Bible teacher has an opinion about how things are going to work out. And what this results in is oftentimes confusion in the pews. What I would like to do is shed some light on the areas of prophecy. Now, I don't claim to have all the answers, but I am going to attempt to preach on several prophetic themes that are presented in the Word of God. And I'm going to try to do it in such fashion that they go in order as things will take place. Like I said, two Sundays ago, we talked about the rapture. Today, I want to preach on the truth about Satan's superhero or Superman. This sermon will focus on the work and the person known as the Antichrist. Why do a series on questions about the future? Well, as I shared with you before, there are many people in our world today that wonder about the future. What lies ahead? What better way to prepare them than to talk about the things that the Bible says are yet to take place? The things that will happen in the future. Friend, you don't have to think about it. you can bank on it that Jesus Christ is going to come again. The rapture is going to take place. The Antichrist is going to be a person that reigns on earth. All these things are going to take place. You don't have to guess on it. You don't have to hope on it. The Bible is the Word of God, and God's Word is true. And we can preach it. We can tell it with all authority because it is God's Word. And it needs to be proclaimed. Because the time is short, and those people that you know, your loved ones, your acquaintances that have yet to know the truth, they need to know the truth. They need to know what is going to take place so that God's Holy Spirit can work in their hearts and lives and draw them into a relationship with our Heavenly Father. You know, our responsibility is just to share the good news of what Jesus Christ has done for us, where our world is today and where we can be today through a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's why we talk about this. You know, it has been said that there have been somewhere around 40 billion people that have lived on earth since Adam was created in the Garden of Eden. Since that time, the world has had many talented, intellectual, powerful people. However, none of those are able to match Satan's superhero, who will be known as the Antichrist. He will be powerful, deceitful, intelligent, brutal, ruthless, and efficient. He will represent the pinnacle of all man can achieve apart from God. He will literally be, like I said, Satan's superhero, almost like Satan himself in human flesh. He's going to be empowered by Satan. When you think of superhero, what do you think about? Well, some would say, well, I think of the Marvel films, the series of all the superheroes like Captain America and Spider-Man and Iron Man, the Avengers, or I think of Batman or Superman, and the list can go on. What do these heroes have in common? They are all trying to fight for law and justice. They are trying to protect those who are innocent. They are trying to protect them from the evil and the injustice that is going on in their society. That's why they say we need superheroes. And friends, we look at our society today and say, you know, where are people that could stand up and say enough is enough? You know, one group claims this and another group claims this and one wants to do this and take away, you know, this and that. But friends, we don't have anybody in our world today that could just stand up and say, enough is enough. But someday, and I'm trying to put this tape on so my microphone will stay. Many of you are looking at me and wondering what he's doing. But someday, Jesus Christ will return and say, enough is enough. Enough is enough. What's it going to take? Or what's going to take place prior to the Antichrist coming on the scene? Well, like I said, the rapture of millions of Christians around the world will be taken off the scene, off the earth. The world will be in chaos, trying to understand what has just happened. Like I said before, my personal view is many will say it's aliens that took all these people. You know, we have a bunch of people that believe in aliens today. The world will be looking for somebody to step forward to bring some semblance of order and leadership. And what an excellent time for Satan's superhero, the Antichrist, to come on the scene. To many of the people, he will seem like a superhero. But in reality, he will be a wolf in sheep's clothing. Then let's see what the Bible says about the Antichrist. First of all, the appearance of Satan's Superman. Our text tells us that in the end times, and actually the Old Testament also says this, that there will be a fierce king who will stand up. But what are the signs of his appearing? Can men know when this man will appear? I know down through the ages there have been people that have prophesied and tried to say that, you know, maybe Hitler was the Antichrist, or
or, you know, different ones down through, or even some of our presidents, some were saying, you know, this person's got to be the Antichrist, only to find themselves wrong and ashamed of and embarrassed in what they had said. But we don't know. Some would say, is the Antichrist alive on the earth today? Well, in my opinion, I believe he could be. I believe he probably is. And I say that because we are living in a world today where we have the capability of making sure somebody doesn't buy or sell without the mark of the beast. You know, we are seeing that shaping up in our world today. You know, we see it, first of all, start with a vaccine. You know, and I'm just, you know, all ready to hear somebody say, well, you know, people that don't have a vaccine shouldn't be able to go to the market, shouldn't be able to buy or sell. But I don't think we're at that point. I know when the Antichrist comes upon the scene, we will have to, or those who will take the mark of the beast will be 666 under the forehead or the hand. We know that Scripture talks about that. And friends, we have that capability right now of doing that. It's been there for some years, but we can see how our world is shaping up for something like this to happen. So in my heart, I believe the Antichrist probably has been born and could possibly come on the scene. But praise the Lord, for us Christians, we won't be here. Okay? We'll be in heaven. When the Antichrist comes on the scene, we will be in heaven. Okay? The pre-rapture. Christ taking the Christians out. He did not destine us to wrath. Okay. When you look at Noah, before he destroyed the world, he took the righteous out. Before God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, he went in and he took the righteous out before destruction came. That's why we place our theory that before the tribulation, Christ will come. And at that time, the Antichrist will come on the scene. The church will be gone. All the conviction that the church brings with it will cease, and people will have the opportunity to do whatever they want. So that leads us to the world condition. When this man makes his entrance, the world will be in a terrible moral condition. This is evidenced by two passages. And let me read those for you. The first one is in Luke chapter 17, verses 20 through 37. And one day the Pharisees asked Jesus, "When will the kingdom of God come?" Jesus replied, "The kingdom of God can't be detected by visible signs. You won't be able to say, 'Here it is, it's over there,' for the kingdom of God is already among you." Then he said to his disciples, "The time has come when you will long to see the day when the Son of Man returns, but you won't see it. People will tell you, 'Look, there is the Son of Man,' or 'Here he is,' but don't go out and follow them. For as the lightning flashes and the sky lights and lights up the sky from one end to the other, so it will be on the day when the Son of Man comes. But first the Son of Man must suffer terribly and be rejected by this generation," which he was crucified. Then he said, "When the Son of Man returns, it will be like in the days of Noah's day. In those days, people enjoyed banquets and parties and weddings right up to the time Noah entered his boat, and the flood came and destroyed them all. And the world will be like as in the days of Lot. People went out about their daily business, eating and drinking and buying and selling, farming and building, until the morning that Lot left Sodom. Then fire and burning sulfur rained down from heaven and destroyed them all. Yes, it will be business as usual right up to the day when the Son of Man is revealed. But on that day, a person out on the deck of the roof must not go down into the house to pack. A person out in the field must not return home. Remember what happened to Lot's wife. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you let your life go, you will save it. That night, two people will be asleep in one bed. One will be taken and the other left. Two women will be grinding flour together at the mill, and one will be taken and the other left. Two women will be in the field, and one be taken and the other left. Where will this happen, Lord? The disciples asked. Jesus replied, just as a gathering of the vultures show there is a carcass nearby, so these signs indicate the end is near. Then let me read out of 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 through 5. You should know this, Timothy, Paul writing to him. In the last days there will be very difficult times. Now I'm going to read these difficult times, and I want you to examine them to today, right now, and we're living. For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Then he says, stay away from people like that. Almost sounds like the day in which we live, isn't it? And it seems to be getting worse rather than better. You know, we hear of some people, you know, and they want you to say, hey, if you see your neighbor doing this, call this and let us know. What did it say here? Friends turning on friends. You know, we're living in that type of world and seems to be getting worse. You know, though both of these passages talk about how man had become wicked, lovers of themselves, forsaking the ways of God in Noah's day, in Lot's day, and in the end times. It is easy to see that our world already bears the marks that has suggested the fulfillment of these conditions. And it is my conviction that the world is ready for Satan's superhero to come on the scene, to appear. Let's take a look. Not only do we see here, first of all, we see that the condition of the world, but the corruption of the religion. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3, the first part it says, but don't be fooled by what they say, for that day will not come until there is a great rebellion against God. And friends, I believe that rebellion is shaping up in our world today. I see it against the church, trying to silence the church. And if we don't go along and agree and celebrate the things that they want to do, then they're going to belittle us, they're going to squelch us, they're going to try to silence us as believers in Christ, as the church. I believe that with all my heart, because I believe Scripture tells us that there is going to be a great rebellion against God. And if it's a rebellion against God, it's a rebellion against God's people. Both of these passages talk about this. These verses tell us that the Antichrist will appear during a time of religious apostasy, which the Bible calls a falling away. It refers to a time when organized, visible religion departs from the doctrines of the Word of God. Since the New Testament was written for us and about believers, it makes sense to conclude that this falling away will be apparent in churches and denominations which operate under the umbrella of Christianity. What we need to remember in these three cases of Noah, Lot, and in the end times, all people have become or will become so rebellious against God. Once upon a time, they knew God, but without careful guarding of their own hearts, sin overtook them to such a point that God could no longer let their rebellion continue. The same is true for us today. God will say, enough is enough. Judgment will come as it did in previous times. as it did in the days of Noah, as it did in the times of Lot, it will in the end times. God is patient and kind, but it seems like when man crosses a line in rebellion and sin, God says, enough. Judgment must be served. I hope everyone understands that just because a church or denomination calls itself a Christian work, it doesn't truly make it so or a fact. In fact, the days in which we live are marked by a rapid departure from the foundations of truth of Christianity. There was a time when a man, when he said that he was a Christian, you pretty much knew what he believed. There might have been a few doctrinal differences, but for most part, a person believed in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. Or he also believed in the substitutionary death and the resurrection of Christ and the return of Christ. Also, he believed that the fact of the Bible was the Word of God. In other words, a Christian was a person who was in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. He accepted all that the Bible teaches concerning him and his work. But now, however, things have changed. A person may deny the virgin birth but still call himself a Christian. Or a person may still call themselves Christian and cast doubt on the accuracy of the Bible. A person may doubt that Jesus Christ really died and rose from the dead and still claim to be saved. Friends, something is wrong with this picture. We are living in the midst of a great falling away. Cults are growing by leaps and bounds while genuine Christianity consistently finds itself under the gun from society, government, and organized religion. Even in our own Southern Baptist Convention, back several years ago, they took steps to remove from their doctrinal statement any room for liberals or the moderates to wiggle. This brought about cries of protest from the world and from the literal crowd within the convention. This last week, one major church within our denomination ordained three women into the roles in the church. This is just another indication of the tide that is swiftly turning against those who believe the Bible and who know Jesus Christ. You know, when denominations have to take votes on whether to marry homosexuals or allow homosexuals to be ordained, or something is wrong, my friend. There are things that are nailed down so firmly in the Word of God that there should never be any question about them. However, we are seeing every major doctrine under attack and seeing churches and denominations turning away from the truth at alarming speed. Truly, we are in the midst of apostasy. If this is the case, then what hinders the Antichrist from appearing on the scene at any moment and keeps the tribulation from starting? There is one event that must take place before the Antichrist can be revealed, before the tribulation period can commence. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3 through 7. Don't be fooled by what I say, for the day will not come until a great rebellion against God and the man of lawlessness is revealed, and the one who brings destruction. He will exalt himself and defy everything that God, that people call God, and every object of worship. He will even sit in the temple of God, claiming himself to be God. Don't you remember that I told you about this when I was with you? Paul asked. Wouldn't have been, you know, I read that statement. I thought, wouldn't it have been neat there to hear Paul? To hear Paul telling about the future, telling about the things that were going to happen. I wished I could have been there to glean from Paul. But he says, hey, don't you remember? I told you all this when I was with you. And you know what's holding him back. For he can be revealed only when his time comes. For this lawlessness is already at work secretly, and it will remain secret until the one who is holding it back steps out of the way. In other words, something is hindering the Antichrist from coming on the scene right now. Which leads us to the third, the completion of the church. The completion of the church in those verses that I just read you. These verses tell us the truth that the church must be revealed before the Antichrist, or the church must be removed before the Antichrist can be revealed. In verse 6 in the King James, it uses the word withholdeth. It also, in verse 7, the one who letteth. In other words, somebody that's holding something back, and then somebody that lets things happen. The Bible tells us that in verse 7, that the spirit of Antichrist is already at work. That is why we see the evidence all around us in our world today. However, there are two forces that hinder him from stepping on the stage and making his presence known. And what are these two hindrances? The church and the Holy Spirit. The church and the Holy Spirit. The work of the Spirit in convicting and judging the hearts of men is a tremendous retaining force in the world. Jesus said this in John 16, 8 through 11. He said, when he comes, Jesus knew he was getting ready to go away, and he started telling them about the Holy Spirit that was going to come in his place. When he left, the Holy Spirit was going to come. And when he came, it says he will convict the world of sin and of God's righteousness and the coming judgment. The world's sin is that it refuses to believe in me. Righteousness is available because I go to the Father and you will see me no more. Judgment will come because the ruler of this world has already been judged. The Spirit's work in filling the church to stand against the tide of evil is a great hindrance to the world and the spirit of the Antichrist. However, one day both of these forces will be removed, and that is going to be at the rapture. In the last days, when the times for the Antichrist arise, God is going to remove much of his restraint and lawlessness that is going on, upon the lawlessness that is going on. Lawlessness will be allowed to run rampant over the earth, and rampant will be a part of the judgment falling upon the earth. Rampage will happen. Men will be allowed to do their own thing and live as they desire to live. The day is coming when men will get their wish and be left to themselves without God interfering. Can you imagine that day? Friends, I don't want to be here, and I'm thankful that God's going to take us. Because can you imagine what's going on with God's presence? I believe the Holy Spirit is going to withdraw himself and allow this to happen. I believe the Holy Spirit's presence is still going to be here on earth, because there are those that are going to be saved during the tribulation period, and they cannot be saved apart from God's Holy Spirit working in their life, drawing them into relationship with God, filling their hearts like he has filled our hearts. But to much of what the Holy Spirit right now is withholding, holding back on the forces of evil, he is going to withdraw much of his presence, and that evil is just be rampant in the world today. I just shudder to think of all that is going to happen. But of course, Satan's going to be ready, and he's going to bring his Antichrist, who's going to try to bring everything together. Like I said before, a wolf in sheep's clothing. But when that happens, when the Holy Spirit and when the church is gone, what are we today to many people? We are a convicting force of what they're doing is not right. And you know from experience, when you're not doing something right, the last person you want to see is somebody coming to tell you that's not right and bringing conviction into your heart and life. Because when you're convicted, then you got to deal with it. And how you're going to deal with it, whether you're going to agree with it and repent of it, or whether you're going to go the other direction and stay in your sin. But right now, we as Christians are a force that God is using because we have the Holy Spirit living inside us. Just as they hated Jesus, Jesus said, hey, they're going to hate you because they hated me. Friends, we might be going up against some forces of darkness that are going to try to silence us. They're going to try to silence our message. When will Christ return? We don't know for sure. But I know before it gets really, really terrible, and we might experience some of the birth pains, And we need to be ready for that. We need to have our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. No matter what happens, He's in control. That's where our faith and trust needs to be. The Antichrist will be revealed. He will appear unveiled. The pulpit commentary says it this way. He will appear in unveiled in all of His naked deformity, no longer working secretly, but openly and in an undisguised form, no longer the mystery, but the revelation of lawlessness. The spirit of sin and lawlessness will find its fulfillment in the Antichrist and his government. He will vent the rage of men against God that has built up for centuries upon the world. He will rise upon the earth, and terrible rage of lawlessness will be cut loose upon mankind. Men will suffer the results of their sin. They will sin and sin and live lawless lives and burn in their lust for more and more. But they will never be satisfied with what they have, nor with the good or the normal or the natural. They will have more than enough, but they will lust, they will burn in their passions more for more and more. And they will bear the terrible inner punishment more and more. Such things as dissatisfaction, emptiness, loneliness, unfulfillment, insecurity, purposelessness, disturbance, conflict, sorrow, restlessness. On the surface, these things may not look all that bad, but think about them for a moment. Imagine the depth and the intensity of each punishment when God is not present to help us through them. The Holy Spirit is going to be withdrawn. God's presence is not going to be here. Friend, I wouldn't want to live in a world like that. You know people that shouldn't live in a world like that, but they don't know, and we need to tell them. That's why I'm sharing these messages with you, to light a fire in you, to say, hey, I've got friends, I've got neighbors, I've got acquaintances that need to know the truth about what is going to happen in the future. I need to warn them about what is going to happen so that they don't have to go through this. Can you imagine yourself going through what I just described? Many of us would say, no, I can't imagine that. Then why would you want your friends, your neighbors, your relatives to go through it? We need to tell them. We need to tell them. The horror, the fear, the despair, the insecurity that will consume the souls of men cannot be described, for men have never lived without the presence of God upon earth to help them. It's worthy to note the point that the tribulation, like I said before, is not for the church. I think of Jeremiah 37, the time of Jacob's trouble. It was told to Daniel that the tribulation was for Israel. Of course, Israel's going to be around during that time. She's going to go through a terrible time. But for the church, the tribulation period was known as a time of God's wrath. And the Bible says that and teaches that God's children have been saved from the wrath through Jesus. I think of Romans chapter 5, verse 9. In the King James, it says, much more than having been justified by His blood, we shall be saved from the wrath through Him. Then in the New Living Translation, it says, since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Jesus Christ, He will certainly save us from God's condemnation. One of the greatest proofs that the church will not see the tribulation is Christ's promise to the church of Philadelphia in Revelation 3:10, which He says to that church, He says, because thou hast kept the word of patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Yeah, I don't know about you, but these verses bring comfort to me and peace to know that I am the Son of God and will not face the wrath of God. Jesus will see to that by taking us out of the wrath of God that is going to proceed upon the world at this time. Well, all that said, let me wrap up this morning. Friend, this is a message, like I said, that we need to be taken to our family. Remember when I started this series, I said, well, why do we ask these questions? Because there are people that want to know. We can start the conversation. when we're with our friends, you know what I learned in church? That the rapture is going to happen. What's about the, can I tell you about the rapture? And start a conversation and tell them what you've learned. Tell them what the Word of God says. Allow the Holy Spirit to begin to do a work in their heart and life. And maybe even give them an appetite to know more of what you're learning about what is going to happen in the future. What's the next event? You know, and keep them wondering and wanting to know more. God has given it to us so that we can understand the times in the future. We must warn them before it's too late for people to repent and turn to Jesus for salvation. Who do you know today that needs to be told about this horrific news of pending doom? Would you say that they are right, have a right to know the truth, or have you become so callous that you don't care? That's the question we need to ask ourselves. I wrote it in this way. I said, would you say that they have a right to know the truth, or have we become so callous that we don't care whether they know it or not? To be honest, some might have even thought they don't deserve to know what's going to happen. If that's the case with any of us, we need to fall on our knees. We need to repent of having such a bitter spirit. And that may apply to us in the room today. We know it's somebody that needs to hear, but we don't want to be the one to tell them. Because maybe we have a bitter spirit towards them. Like I said, if that's the case, then we need to repent and get right with God ourselves. God has shared these things with us so that we can share them with other people. It's not for us to decide who is worthy and who is not. You know, we can't play God when somebody's life hangs in the balance, I wrote. We must be faithful to do what God has called us to do and share the good news of forgiveness through Jesus Christ. We must stand before God someday. That what we are going to have to answer for, whether we have been faithful or not. God may turn to us and say, Steve, how come you weren't faithful to share my word with others? I wrote it so that you can understand. And Steve, I know that you understood it, but why didn't you share it with your family? Why didn't you share it with your friends? What would you say if God said that to you someday? Will our labor for God stand? Or will it be burned up someday? Friend, you decide. Will you stand before God empty-handed with nothing to show? I pray not. But I can't make that choice for you. Only you can. Only you can. He's given us a message. He's given us a wonderful message. The hope for all the world. Salvation through Jesus Christ. You know, some people would say, well, people would turn me off if I just start talking about Jesus Christ. Well, start talking about the issues that are going on in the world today. During our Sunday school lesson, one of the ladies shared that she was 35 when she came to know Christ as her Savior. She knew what it was like before, and she knows what it's like after, and how Christ has made a difference, how Christ has ministered to her heart, how Christ is her Lord and Savior. That's what she can share, but then she can share, you know, you can know Him too. And share with them the gospel that Jesus loves them and He died on the cross. Not only did He die on the cross, but He rose again the third day, triumphing over death. And now He is able to give life to all who will turn to Him, repent of their sins, and accept Him. And when they do, they're made right with God. Friends, what's holding us back? Someday we will stand before God. And give an answer. I hope and pray that what we present Him will not be burned up, but that it will stand. Maybe that day we can turn around and see individuals that our lives touched and were in heaven because of the life we lived and the things that we shared with them. This is what we need to be about. We need to be doing it now. Don't put it off to tomorrow. Don't put it off and say, I'll get to it someday. That someday may never come. Let's do it now. Let's bow for prayer. Father, thank you for the message that you laid upon my heart. Father, I'm not trying to be cruel to people, but just share truths from your word. Lord, we are living in a world that seems to be rapidly going in the wrong direction. Lord, help us to be bold in sharing the truth with love and compassion, not with hatred, not with cruelty. Lord, any life that is bound by sin can be freed through the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, help us to get that message out. For those who are in bondage today, who have no way of being freed from sin, Lord, help us help those people. Lord, give us the ears, give us the eyes, give us the opportunities to reach out and to share your love with them, your good news of what Jesus has done and can do for them. For I pray this, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. As we close this morning, we're going to sing a song, as we have been, a song of commitment to the Lord. I believe we have heard the word. Now it's time for us to commit to the Lord and go out into the world and share with the world that God loves them. So would you stand with me? Take my life. Lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Take my life, lead me, Lord. Make my life useful to Thee. Here am I, send me, Lord. Make my Father, we have committed ourselves to you. And now as we go beyond these doors, help us to be a ray of hope, a ray of light in a world of darkness. Father, help us to see those that you bring into our path this week, those who need a gentle touch, a kind word spoken to, those who we need to talk to interest them more in finding out more about you. Father, for those who you give us the opportunity to go in depth and share the Word of God, Father, we pray that you might be glorified, that lives and souls may be drawn close to you, closer to you, and maybe someone give their heart and life to you this week through our efforts. This we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Dum 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 dum.